Good morning. I'd like to thank Amy and Doug for the opportunity to present at the postgraduate course today. Over the next 20 minutes, we'll talk about the optimal approach to the diagnosis of Lynch syndrome, and I think this comes at a very important time with Joe Biden's Cancer Moonshot initiative, and the detection of Lynch syndrome in patients with colorectal cancer is one of the major initiatives. So the objectives of this morning's talk is for you to recognize the importance of microsatellite instability in the diagnosis of Lynch syndrome. I want you to be able to differentiate the causes of microsatellite instability in colon cancers, and then utilize molecular testing for the diagnosis of Lynch syndrome. Lynch syndrome causes about 5 to maybe 10% of all colorectal cancers, and the cancers in individuals with Lynch syndrome demonstrate microsatellite instability. There are four different genes that you all have in your germline if you don't have Lynch syndrome, and those mismatch repair genes are responsible for microsatellite stability. The genes include MLH1, MSH2, MSH6, and PMS2. And when there's gene alterations, mutations in the mismatch repair genes, that causes microsatellite instability within a colorectal cancer. Lynch syndrome, by definition, is a patient who has a germline mutation in one of the mismatch repair genes. And it's very important to know that HNPCC does not equal Lynch syndrome. So let's talk a little bit about the colorectal cancer and Lynch syndrome. The median age is about 45 years. It's preferentially proximal and right-sided. And some tip-offs in pathology could be that the pathology report states the tumor has tumor-infiltrating lymphocytes, a Crohn's-like lymphoid reaction. The pathology can be mucinous, signet cell, or have a medullary growth pattern. And when we talk about the most common mismatch repair genes that cause Lynch syndrome, you can see there by age on the y-axis and across the top the different gene mutations, MLH1 and MSH2, which comprise about 90% of the germline mutations that cause Lynch syndrome, and MSH6, that it isn't 100% lifetime risk of colorectal cancer within Lynch syndrome. Actually, the lifetime estimates are about 50% or less and do vary by the germline, the gene mutation. The biologic principles of colorectal cancer I think you need to know about, and when you take a look on the left side of the figure there, you can see that the adenoma is by far and away the most common precursor to colorectal cancer in the United States. And the hereditary cancer syndromes including FAP, MAP, and Lynch syndrome all develop through adenomas. However, the molecular pathway differs. Microsatellite stability is the cause of FAP, MAP, and sporadic cancers. But Lynch syndrome, as I said before, develops through the microsatellite instability pathway. 20% of colorectal cancers in the United States develop from sessile serrated polyps, and they are the most common cause of microsatellite unstable tumors. So knowing the biologic causes of microsatellite instability in colorectal cancer tumors is quite important for gastroenterologists. Could you advance the slides, please?
Okay.
The causes of microsatellite instability, so again, germline mutations in the mismatch repair genes, or genetic changes within sessile serrated polyps, and those, they are also characterized by BRAF mutations, MLH promoter methylation, and those are the things that you need to keep in mind either on a board exam or when you're thinking about your patients with microsatellite unstable tumors. Well, how do you make this diagnosis of microsatellite instability? In your molecular pathology, the pathologist can actually do two different tests. One includes the MSI test, which is an electropherogram that shows differences in mono and dinucleotide repeats. And if you take a look at the cartoon, on the top part, you can see what this pattern is in normal tissue, and it's compared on the bottom part of the cartoon to the tumor DNA, and you can see there's differences in the peaks of those markers that they take a specific look at. And there is an NCI-related panel, and there's some homegrown panels, but this can be done in your molecular pathology lab. And in addition, immunohistochemistry can also be used to look at the byproducts of mutations in the mismatch repair gene. So immunohistochemistry looks at the protein expression of these mismatch repair genes. On the left side of the figure, you can see the expression of one of the mismatch repair proteins, MLH1. It's present as brown in the nuclei, both in the tubulovillous adenoma at the top part of the screen, as well as in the tumor in the lower half. And if you look on the right side of the screen, you can see that the MSH2 is not expressed either in the tubulovillous adenoma or the tumor. So how do you make the diagnosis of Lynch syndrome? Well, the importance is taking a family history. It should include cancer and stages of death in three generations of relatives, including the age of cancer as well as the ages of death and the presence of both benign and malignant tumors. And a quick thing to do in the endoscopy suite would be this risk assessment tool. So with these three questions, it can be very helpful. Do you have a first-degree relative with any of the following under the age of 50? Colorectal cancer or some of the non-colonic cancers that can be seen in patients with Lynch syndrome? Have you had the following diagnosis less than the age of 50? Personal history of colorectal cancer or colorectal polyps? Or do you have three or more relatives with colorectal cancer? And in this interesting study that was validated, if an individual says yes, that identifies 95% of patients with Lynch syndrome, and it identifies about 77% of individuals that should go on to a risk assessment with a genetic counselor or even with you if that's in part of your practice. So what do we worry about in a family history? Well, these are the old criteria that were developed really to do research on large families that had these cancers. And the Amsterdam criteria 1 for HNPCC is 3-2-1. It's three or more relatives with colorectal cancer, with two or more successive generations being affected, and one first-degree relative actually links the other two relatives in the family. The colorectal cancers need to be diagnosed less than the age of 50, and you want to exclude other colorectal cancer hereditary syndromes like FAP. Unfortunately, 40% of patients who meet this phenotype, this family tree, don't have Lynch syndrome. The Amsterdam 2 criteria were then developed to take into consideration individuals that have the extra colonic cancers that can be seen in patients with Lynch syndrome. And you can see the cartoon on the left side of the screen there. The other organs that can be affected include brain, skin, stomach, pancreaticobiliary tract, the urothelial tract, small bowel, and endometrial and ovarian cancer. And so the Amsterdam 2 criteria included basically 3-2-1. Three or more relatives that have one of those, either colonic or extracolonic cancers. Again, you have to have two or more successive generations and one first-degree relative to the other two with a cancer under the age of 50. But what are the accuracy of those methods as well as some other methods to make the diagnosis of Lynch syndrome? So you can see at the top part of the table, the Amsterdam criteria 2, the sensitivity is only 22%, however, it has good specificity. There are some pathologically based guidelines called the revised Bethesda criteria that have better sensitivity, but slightly less sensitivity than the Amsterdam criteria 2. There are some online models that you can do when you have a patient in the office, and I think the easiest one to access is the PREM 126, and there's a new model called PREM 5. And that includes personal and family history data and ages of onset of the cancers. And you can see with PREM 126 that the sensitivity is up to 90%. However, the specificity is pretty low at 67%. And then when it comes to the tumor testing using either MSI or IHC, it has probably the highest overall sensitivity and specificity compared to those phenotypic or family tree pedigrees that we talked about or even the models. What is the importance of testing the tumor to make the diagnosis of Lynch syndrome rather than just looking at a family tree or using a model? Well, this was an interesting study that Heather Hample did at Ohio State. She took 1,000 unselected colon cancers, and when they did tumor testing, found that nearly 20% of them were microsatellite unstable. Only 21 of those patients actually had microsatellite instability due to Lynch syndrome. So again, speaking to the fact that sessile serrated polyps are the most common causes of the cancer that have microsatellite instability. Importantly, when you took the family history, 43% of those individuals that had Lynch syndrome were diagnosed over the age of 50, and 22% didn't meet the Amsterdam Criteria 2 or the Bethesda guidelines. And I think the real important thing of making this diagnosis in a proactive fashion is that of these 21 individuals that were diagnosed with Lynch syndrome, 117 relatives were tested, and 52 additional individuals that didn't know that they were at risk of getting colorectal and other cancers were diagnosed with Lynch syndrome. And so there has been national organizations that have called for universal testing for microsatellite instability in colorectal tumors, including a CDC branch, the Evaluation of Genomic Applications in Practice and Prevention, the U.S. Multi-Society Task Force on Colorectal Cancer, and the American College of Gastroenterology. So let's talk about microsatellite instability. Other than making a proactive diagnosis of Lynch syndrome, how does it affect our patient management if someone has microsatellite instability versus not? So this was a study looking at 161 families that met the Amsterdam Criteria 1. And when you take a look at the individuals that had microsatellite instability, you can see that their rates of cancer are substantially increased over the SEER cancer database, including colon and the extracolonic cancer risk that we talked about. When they took the same families that met Amsterdam Criteria 2, but had no evidence of microsatellite instability, and we're talking about thousands of relatives, you can see compared to the SEER database that these individuals, whose families looked very compelling for Lynch syndrome, had only a twofold increased risk of colorectal cancer over the general population and none of the extracolonic cancers. And when the study investigators did the analysis, you can see that the only increased risk of cancer, in fact, was in colorectal cancer compared to the individuals that had Lynch syndrome. So important to make the diagnosis because it impacts on how we're going to survey individuals. So those individuals that have a compelling family tree, no evidence of microsatellite instability, have been named familial colorectal cancer type X, and we'll talk about the management strategies and how they differ than Lynch individuals. This is some other work from that study that shows the SEER database, so you can see the age of onset of cancer and the cumulative lifetime risk is much lower in patients in the general population than familial colorectal cancer type X, which is much less than individuals with Lynch syndrome. And it's important to make the diagnosis of Lynch syndrome because it impacts the operation. The type of operation impacts the metachronous occurrence of colorectal cancer. So this was data from the Cancer Family Registry. They looked at a number of individuals with Lynch syndrome, and they compared doing an extended colectomy, which is an iliorectal anastomosis or iliosigmoid anastomosis, to a conventional cancer operation, a segmental colectomy. And what they found is that the Lynch individuals that underwent the extended colectomy had no metachronous cancers on follow-up versus those in the limited colectomy group. And you can see the segmental colectomy group, there's about a 40% recurrence at 20 years after the original operation. So it really behooves gastroenterologists to talk to the surgeons and talk to the pathologists to ensure that our patients are getting the right operation so they don't have a recurrent cancer. What about the gastroenterologist and biopsy of cancers or adenomas? So we can actually send cancers detected in the endoscopy suite down to the pathologist and have microsatellite instability or IHC done. But you can also do it in adenomas. So I'm not advocating that anyone walk out and do it in all of their adenomas, but this was an interesting study that was done on individuals that were known to have Lynch syndrome, and it looked at the detection rates for MSI and IHC by size of adenoma. And what you can see is that both MSI and IHC were equally effective in making the diagnosis of Lynch syndrome in large adenomas that are 10 millimeters or greater, and IHC is better than MSI for the medium-sized polyps. So you can maximize the preoperative diagnosis of Lynch syndrome by having your molecular pathologist do it on colorectal cancers that you detect in the endoscopy suite, or in individuals that have compelling family history. So you might want to consider it in individuals that have an adenoma that's proximal, large, and they're less than age 40, and certainly patients with adenomas in a family history that's compelling for HNPCC or Lynch syndrome. So at the Cleveland Clinic, basically what we do is take all resected colorectal cancers, we subject them to MSI as our first test because MSI is needed for the oncologist to offer the right chemotherapy. It goes on to immunohistochemistry, they meet with a genetic counselor, and then they undergo mutation testing as appropriate. This is the algorithm that was in the Multi-Society Task Force publication in 2014 that basically starts with the tumor where you're looking for MSI or IHC. If you have loss of MLH1, again, that can be due to a BRAF mutation or promoter methylation in MLH1, which is the hallmark of a sessile serrated polyp. And if that, in fact, is present within the tumor, it's a sporadic tumor, and you follow sporadic guidelines for that individual. However, if the immunohistochemistry, the loss of MLH1, is not associated with a BRAF mutation and there's no promoter methylation in the tumor, then that patient needs to go on to the genetic assessment and germline testing for MLH1 mutations. If the other mismatch repair genes that we talked about are not expressed in the tumor, the proteins, then that individual is suspicious for Lynch syndrome and needs to go on to a genetic assessment, and you manage the patient and the family according to the genetic test results. So to think about it, HNPCC is the umbrella term. We divide those individuals into tumors that have MSI or abnormal IHC versus not. And if there's a germline mismatch mutation found in your patient, they have Lynch syndrome, and you follow those specific guidelines. If there's no MSI, it's familial colorectal cancer type X, and it's a colonoscopy every 3 to 5 years. Things have gotten a little bit complex recently. So there has been individuals who you say, oh gosh, Mrs. Jones, your tumor had evidence of microsatellite instability. It's lost expression of the MSH2 protein in the tumor. And we can't find a germline mutation in MSH2 when we check you. And recently it's been found that up to 50% of those individuals that have an MSI tumor, they lack expression of one of the mismatch repair proteins and no germline mutations, have mutations within the tumor. So they have biallelic somatic mutations. And those individuals have a sporadic cancer. They looked very Lynch-like. They might have had a compelling family history. They had MSI. They had loss of protein expression, but no germline mutation. So 50% of those individuals actually need to have their tumor tested at a special lab to find that they've had biallelic somatic mutations. They're sporadic individuals. They don't need the aggressive surveillance like the Lynch syndrome individuals. And those individuals whose tumor didn't have those mutations, it's called Lynch-like syndrome, and they need to be followed according to the Lynch recommendations. So I have a few slides in here of the approach to patients in your office that may be unaffected with cancer themselves. So if you have a patient in your office and they say, gosh, you know, my mom had endometrial cancer, her sister had colon cancer, her mother had colon cancer, you could go on to do tumor testing of the affected relative, as we talked about. And if the tumor in the relative is microsatellite stable, Lynch syndrome is not the cause of the family cancer, and then you just survey them according to the family history. If the tumor in the relative shows microsatellite instability, or it's not available, you can offer germline mutation testing to the person in your office, the unaffected relative. If the Lynch syndrome mutations are found, that person has Lynch syndrome, and then you test that person's first-degree relatives. If the relatives have the mutation, they're diagnosed with Lynch syndrome, and you follow the surveillance. And if relatives don't have the family mutation, then those relatives are not at risk, and they return to average risk screening. I think the important point is you can get the archived cancer specimens from labs, and those can be run with these tests. So the patient in your office said, I had colon cancer when I was age 38. I don't know if I have Lynch syndrome or their relatives. So what is the approach to the unaffected patient if the affected relative is available? Well, if no tumor is available or no germline mutation is found in the affected relative, Lynch-like syndrome is not excluded as the cause of the family cancer, and you have to follow those individuals according to what you do for individuals with Lynch syndrome. And if the affected patient is not available, I have some more tips here. It's a little bit complex, so when you have some time, just think about these different approaches and how they might benefit your patients in the office. But the bottom line is what we need to do as gastroenterologists, once we've made the diagnosis of Lynch syndrome, we have to survey our patients in a specific manner. So colonoscopy is shown to have substantial decrease on the incidence as well as mortality of colorectal cancer. And you begin with colonoscopy at ages 20 to 25 every 1 to 2 years, or 10 years younger than the youngest relative that was affected, unless the relative was quite young, less than the age of 25, and then you advance at 2 to 5 years. Women need to undergo aggressive endometrial and ovarian cancer screening at the age of 30 to 35 with a transvaginal ultrasound and endometrial biopsy every 1 to 2 years. And they should be counseled to consider total abdominal hysterectomy and BSO after childbearing or by the age of 40 to decrease their risk of ovarian, endometrial, fallopian tube, and peritoneal cancer. EGD is recommended at a minimum at the baseline, 30 to 35 years old, with a biopsy for H. pylori and treatment if available, and you can consider it in high-risk populations every 2 to 3 years. And urothelial cancer screening, again, begins at the age of 30 to 35, looking for red blood cells in the urine every 1 year, but the data to support that is limited. So in conclusion, I hope that you all can think about microsatellite instability as the hallmark of colorectal cancer and Lynch syndrome, but the most frequent cause of microsatellite unstable tumors is sessile serrated polyps. Test the tumor for the diagnosis of Lynch syndrome and confirm with germline mutation testing. And patients with MSI-related colorectal cancers and no germline mutations should have somatic testing of the tumor. Thanks for your attention.